popular and accepted and have an attractive man or woman with me. And that is often rooted in selfish behaviors that cause harm in other people's lives. And so if you want more money just for the sake of having money because you'll feel better, then you're also going to be creating more poverty somewhere else in life. But if you are happy just being who you are and celebrating and being love and being open to receiving wealth and living your life with this openness, then you're not harming anybody else. You're benefiting everybody because you're creating freedom. So financial freedom is how you interact with finances. It's not based upon a number. It's not based upon control. Freedom is not control. They're very different. We see this also in politics and our governments. The government gives us the belief that the more control it has over its citizens, then the more free we are. So by creating more control, more laws that control, we're protecting your freedoms. That's a misnomer. It's opposite. You can't control something and say you're giving it freedom. In the same way, you cannot create war in order to attain peace. So that's another illusion that's been propagated in humanity, and it's still going on today. You know, we fight wars in order to ensure your peace. Well, we've been fighting wars for hundreds of years, and still peace is not here. Maybe we need to start creating peace in order to create peace. In the same way, maybe we need to give people more freedom so that they understand their choices and so that they create and uphold a life of freedom.
I understand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So,
I also wanted to ask you another question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a moment?
Yes.
Okay. I noticed that, like, in my interactions with people, sometimes emotions come up and I'm often trying to understand them. Like, is this a dysfunctional emotion from my ego, or is this just a natural emotion that's trying to teach me something? And one of the emotions I noticed was like in my interaction with other students, sometimes I'll feel something that where I'm guided to, I don't know if I should say guided, but I feel like I shouldn't be working with a particular person closely. And my ego will, of course, try to understand and be like, okay, is that, that's not, you know, fair to that person. Or is, you know, that may be judgmental. So I'm trying to, you know, I'm going through this thing trying to understand the emotion. And a lot of times I think I may be creating too much work for myself. So I wanted to kind of ask you about that and when to know that I can trust my emotions and when.
Okay, every emotion is a teacher. And so when someone says, like you said, how do I know if my emotion is teaching me something or if it's just my ego? Well, every emotion is a teacher. And when you observe and examine the emotion, you'll see what the cause is. Sometimes it's your own ego's resistance to life, or its own projection upon life. And other times it's the natural symbiotic flow of emotions happening in your environment amongst everybody. The higher, when you're living in the higher self state, there's only divine love. All the other emotions have already been cleansed and integrated, and there's just peace and love and joy. So that's the goal of where we're going in our own spiritual evolution. It doesn't negate the emotions happening in the environment. It changes them. So for example, in my life, I always have this joy, this happiness, this love within me. And to a person observing my body, they may not see me smiling from ear to ear. They may not see me talking about spiritual things, but there's always this joy and this love within me. While I'm in this state of joy and love, I'll also be feeling the emotions of other people, but it's outside of me. It's not in my own energy system. Instead, it's in my auric field. It's in my awareness. It's in my energy system, but it's outside of me. And I clearly know that. I can clearly feel from who it's coming from. And so with greater awareness, you'll be able to discern what the source of the emotion is. Is it something that they're generating, or is it something that I'm generating? And if it is something I'm generating, why am I creating it? What part of me is creating it? Is it my higher self, my conscious awareness in this present moment, in this superconscious state? Or is it something from my subconscious mind, some memory, some pattern, some egoic behavior? So every emotion will teach us something, because we're the observing awareness, we're the student that's learning. So what's important in the way that I teach it is to use your awareness to look at it, observe it, and understand it. Don't use your mind to try to control it. It's very common that when we feel something undesirable, we immediately try to control it and get rid of it. We try to push it away. I don't like it. I don't want to feel that. But it'll keep coming back. We need to look at it, observe it in a detached way with meditative type awareness so that we understand it. When we understand it, then we can create a new solution. So if we realize that we have created a judgment about a person in a classroom and we see this, we can see that it does not serve us. We can see how ridiculous it was, that we didn't even know this person, and we've jumped to a conclusion about them with inadequate information, and it's not making our lives better. It's not making their life better. You know, it's creating unhappiness within me, and I'm generating that in the emotion, and I'm sending it to this person as well. And so just that can be enough to say, okay, I want to create something different. I don't want that anymore. And then we start to act a different way, create a different emotion, feel more peace, treat this person differently. So to stay within your mind and to keep thinking about something is not going to create a solution. In order to heal your emotions or to change your emotions, you have to move from your thought to your emotional energy itself. You have to learn how to create emotional energy. That's how we heal the emotions, is by learning to create emotional energy. So I've created the CD, the Higher Self-Guided Chakra Meditation, Awaken and Heal Your Chakras. That teaches a person how to generate emotional energy. It guides the person to take their awareness into their chakras one at a time, to understand it, to examine it, to learn about it. And then it guides them to take to create the energy of divine love in each chakra. So this is the foundational way that I understand and that the higher self teaches to most effectively heal the chakras. It's very direct. To think about our problems, to think about our emotions, to try to think our way through life is not a very effective way. Most human beings are living in their thoughts. And when we look at a human being's life, we see that most human beings do not create a lot of change in their emotional structure, in their karma. They repeat the same relationships, the same patterns for a lifetime and many lifetimes. And throughout each of these lifetimes, they've been thinking about their problems nearly nonstop. So thinking about problems and trying to mentally construct a solution to emotional issues is not a real solution. It's not effective. We can see that when we examine human behavior and examine ourselves. What we need to do is learn what the emotions are by bringing our awareness into them, and then learn how to create emotional energy. In that way, we're actually creating something in the emotional body. Thinking about the emotions is not creating anything in the emotional body. In the same way, a person can learn all there is to know about weightlifting and bodybuilding, and they can fill their mind with all the information. They can understand conceptually what to do, but it's not in any way going to increase the size of their muscles or the strength of their body. The only way to build muscle is to lift heavy weights. The only way to heal your emotion is to create new emotional energy. Being a mentalist about life is not going to create change. Ideas will change the content in your mind, but ideas will not create action in your body, and it will not create emotional energy. It's just ideas. They're very, very superficial and shallow in the reach of their energy depth, so to speak. So a lot of people come to me saying, I understand spiritual things. I've been studying this for 10 years, but my life is the same. I have the same problems. I keep reappearing, the same situations. I suffer the same. And what I tell them is, first you have to learn and first you have to understand. Yes. And you've done that. Wonderful. But now you have to actually do something. If it's emotional problems that you're having, you need to learn how to control your emotional energy, how to create new ones, how to stop old patterns. You need to learn what the emotional energy is. That's the only way you're going to know. If you want to learn how to swim, you have to jump in the water. You can't stand on the side and tell me the mass of water and the density and how, you know, will you'll float and, you know, the temperature of the water and the depth of the pool. That doesn't matter at all. You can't swim until you jump in. You can't heal your emotions until you start learning what they are, until you start creating them and feeling them and understanding them. In the same way, you can't heal your body just by thinking about it. You have to change your behaviors. This is very, very, very common. So you're not alone in this. This is how society works. We live in a thought-controlled society. I wouldn't even say it's mind-controlled because we're not even using our minds. We're using such a small fragment, which is thought. Information controls the world. Intelligence does not. The mind has intelligence as what it is. It's ability to process and learn and to remember and to integrate. But we're letting information control our lives. And information...
Can I say something?
Yes.
I'm having difficulty understanding what to do because I've been trying to use my mind less, which I mean thoughts less, and just staying aware. But then also staying aware is not really going to help if I don't make a change, a physical change. So I think I'm confused about what to do.
Okay. So if you lived in a monastery in which you did not have to worry about much, I shouldn't say worry, in which you did not have to be very involved in life. So in a monastery, your responsibilities are tending your garden and cooking the food and cleaning or building the structures. That's about it. Or even in a monastery, you would beg for food and you don't need to grow your own food. In some monasteries, you have volunteers cleaning. So some monks can just meditate all day long. So they can do nothing. They can stay in awareness and they'll be fine. But for the other aspects of humanity that have to live in a society or that choose to live in a society, we have to learn how to integrate our spirituality with our own day-to-day life. And so we have to learn how to act, how to speak, how to perform jobs or tasks. And this makes our lives more challenging. And so staying in awareness is not something that you have to isolate yourself to do. It's very, very safe, very comfortable, and the ego loves to isolate itself because it's secure, it's comfortable. I don't have to think about life. There's no change going on. But the challenge has always been bring your spirituality into your day-to-day life. It's easy to be peaceful when you're sitting on your cushion. But now you go to work, and now you're around people who are loud, who are aggressive, who are dramatic. You work for a boss who doesn't treat you very well. Now's the challenge. Now try to keep your peace. So staying in awareness is getting you in touch with you. And it's going to help you understand your life. It's going to help you understand how to live, but it's not going to live for you. Being in awareness, you don't move. Like the fullest state of awareness is sitting in meditation. You don't move.
Let me ask you, when I'm in awareness, for example, in my day-to-day life, and I see situations that are not, you know, desirable, like, for example, someone has strong body odor and it just takes your attention, you know, out of your peace or, you know, whatever it may be. Somebody's communicating with you in a way that you wouldn't want to be communicated with, and that's taking you out of your peace. Okay, in that moment, you're saying be aware of what's happening and then act appropriately.
Yes, you have to understand the situation and then you have to take some sort of action, either mentally, physically, or emotionally. So in your situations, if I was in